Religion is all about sex, period.
That's why Steeple's really just a big phallus.
Yeah, I will give you some hints about how sex is the bottom line in all religion. Christianity is based solely on sex. Let me just give you one of the thousand examples I could give you. The Ten Commandments. Charlton Heston playing in the movie The Ten Commandments. Yeah. So you see Moses coming down from the mountain with the Ten Commandments. Well, what you don't know is that the Bible reference works. If you go to an encyclopedia of the Bible in UCLA or USC, a county USC universities, or to the big seminaries, the big university seminaries for Christianity, well, you need to understand why are they call it a seminary. You're going to be a preacher, you're going to be a minister, you got to go to a seminary. Study all about the word, and then they will show you how the word Cohen is a Jewish word for a priest. The name for a priest in Judaism was called Cohen. A lot of Jews have the last name of Cohen. Mm-hmm. Cohen is a priest in Judaism. But do you know what Cohen means in Hebrew?
What?
It means the protector of the human semen.
Stop.
He protects the human semen. So therefore, he's in charge of you having babies. If you're a Jew, you talk to the rabbi, because he is the rabbinical authority over your body and how you reproduce. So the Christians have a seminary, but the Jews have a holy priesthood called Cohen. And the word Cohen, translated from the original word that gives us the word Cohen, means protectors of the semen. This is why God is called the Father, our Father. Why? Because the Father is the male. He impregnates Mother Nature. Mother Earth. Mother Earth is Mother Nature. So therefore, in the spring, that's the time for the spring weddings. The reason why you have those spring weddings is because that's when God the Father is going to impregnate Mother Earth with the sacred fluid. And so the ancient people said God the Father, the ancient Hindu name for God was Rain, R-A-I-N. Look it up in a dictionary. The Rain, R-A-I-N, was the name of God the Father in Hindu religion. And so when you have a spring wedding, God the Father is going to impregnate Mother Earth, Mother Nature, with this sacred fluid called rain. Mm-hmm. And the rain comes from the Father in heaven. Obviously, it must come from the Father. And so, therefore, it's going to impregnate the earth. And all the flowers are going to grow. All the plants are going to grow. The food's going to grow. And now we will have food to eat, beautiful flowers. All the animals will come out. They will reproduce. And the humans and all the boys will be chasing the girls in the spring, because it's just natural. It's just plain old, down-home natural.
Yes.
Guys are looking for the women, and the women are playing with the guys. And so why? Because it's just male and female, and it's the springtime for weddings. And that's why Jesus, in the Bible, that Jesus and his mother went to the marriage feast of Cana, to a big marriage, and his mother went with him. And his mother's name was Mary. Mary is the mother of Jesus. Her name was Mari, M-A-R-I, not M-A-R-Y. Mary is M-A-R-Y. In the Bible, Jesus' mother was M-A-R-I,
wow.
Mari. Mari is a Latin word meaning a virgin. Well, that's what Jesus is, born of a virgin. Yeah, he's born of Mari, not Mary. Hell, everybody knows Mary is anything but a virgin. All the guys in town know who Mary is. But nobody knows Mari, M-A-R-I. That's why she's a virgin. Yeah, and so look it up in the dictionary. Look it up in the Bible encyclopedias. Jesus' mother was spelled M-A-R-I, Mari. You get one of those big, strong Bible concordances.
Mm-hmm.
The big, it's not that expensive. It's only about $19.95. It's from Amazon. It's a big, huge volume with every word ever used in the Bible,
yes.
Period, and what it meant, where it came from, and what it actually meant. It's all there. If you just take 20 years out of your life and sit and study. Yeah, if you just do that, take 20 to... Or if you want to be like me, take 60 years of your life to study, day in and day out, all the words, the terms, the ideas, the concepts of religion and theology. My God, what a world that is of ancient theology. So anyway,
when
you talk about God the Father impregnating Mother Earth, that's why today, in any marriage, the male in a marriage is going to manufacture. So he's going to work with his partner, and he's going to manufacture while his partner is going to be in labor. His partner is going to be in labor building the package that he has manufactured. Because the man is going to impregnate the female. She's going to create the project. She's going to create the product. So she is in labor building the product that he has manufactured. Let me go back to Moses and the Ten Commandments, because I got off on that. So we're told that Moses goes up into the mountain and sees and talks to God. And God gives him something called the Ten Commandments. That whole story is so incredibly impregnated with stuff you have never heard before and have no idea in the world what's being said. It will absolutely knock you over when you find out the real story that's hid by the church about Moses. Incredible. So Moses goes up and he goes up the side of the mountain. The children of Israel are down below on the land. They're down below and they're dancing around a golden calf. Golden calf is one of the signs of the zodiac. One of the signs of the zodiac is Taurus, the bull. So for 2,150 years, the sun rises each morning in the sign of Taurus, the bull. Well, the sun is golden and the bull is a calf. So the golden calf is the sun in the constellation of Taurus, the bull. And so therefore, when Moses goes up into the mountain, he comes down and God has given him a whole new religion. It's a brand new religion that Moses comes down from the mountain and he sees the Hebrew people still worshiping the old religion. They just don't get it. They're worshiping the old religion of the golden calf, the constellation of Taurus, and the constellation of Taurus, the bull. Which, of course, this is why when the Pope issues an order, it's called a papal bull. Why? Because of Taurus, the bull of the constellation of the zodiac. My God, there's so much to tell you.
One of the chatters is, they're asking you to elaborate more on the Moses story.
Yeah, Moses, okay. So Moses never lived. There was no such a man named Moses. He never lived. There was a pharaoh, a line of pharaohs, which were called Thutmoses. Thutmoses the first, Thutmoses the second. Thut is our word thought, meaning the pharaohs were the thought of God. And the thought of God was Moses. Thutmoses the first, Thutmoses the second. So Moses was nothing. He never lived. There was no such a man named Moses. So if you're basing your religion on Moses, then you got zero nothing. You got sand. You don't have a religion. You got an incredible, misunderstood lie exception. And this is why Abraham, all the Jews talk about Abraham, all three major religions, Islam, Judaism, and Christianity, they claim Abraham. There, in point of fact, historically, never existed a man named Abraham. It's just a story. The Bible is called the greatest story ever told. I used to get my butt kicked by my mother when she would find me telling stories. She would say, "You out telling stories again?" And I was out telling stories. So telling stories used to mean you out lying through your teeth. You're out there telling a bunch of stories.
Yes.
And so a storyteller was always understood to be somebody who's out there lying and trying to sell you something. And so you were a storyteller. Well, this is why the Bible is called the greatest story ever told. It's not the greatest collection of historical facts ever published. It's the greatest story ever told. It's just a story. And you don't know that. There's nothing true in it. There was no Moses. There was no Jesus. Jesus never existed. There was no Moses. He never existed. There was no King Solomon. Solomon never lived. There was no king. In actual history, none of these people actually lived.
But then, Jordan, we have a huge problem. All of our Palestinian brothers and sisters who's been dispossessed and disinherited from their land and died trying to resist the state of Israel, you're basically saying they got the land because why? They're the chosen people of God because of Moses and Abraham, right? But if that's not true, then they're really not the chosen people of God. So what are we doing with them taking these people's land and setting up shop?
Well, hell, they were going to get screwed anyway, so it's about time somebody does it. The idea in America is that poor, ignorant, dim-witted people, and uneducated, goofy, beer-drinking, stupid, ignorant people, and ignorant people drinking beer and watching TV all day are going to get screwed. They're going to get ripped off. And since they're going to get ripped off, hell, what are we waiting for? We might as well rip them off ourselves. So therefore, we call it Israel. When the Hyksos people, the word was Hyksos, there was an ancient people many thousands of years ago in the Middle East. They were called Hyksos. And the Hyksos people illegally crossed over into Egypt. They were not Egyptians. They were Hyksos. They were a robber band. They were a band of robbers. They were like a gang of bikers. So they were called Hyksos. Why? Because that's what they did for a living. They roamed around and they pulled into town. They rape and drink and destroy and take anything they want. And then when there's nothing left, they move on to the next town. I mean, they're so stupid they're going to get raped anyway. So might as well be us. Somebody's going to do it somewhere. So might as well be us. And so when Moses comes down with the Ten Commandments, this is one hell of a story. When Moses comes down from the mountain with the Ten Commandments, we remember what the Ten Commandments look like. It's a big, huge stone. Mm-hmm. And all the stones are written the Ten Commandments. Well, if you go to the Encyclopedia of Christianity, the different dictionaries and encyclopedia references in the seminaries where the priests go, and read the reference work, read the seminary, and look up the word Ten Commandments, they will tell you the Ten Commandments were not ten big stones. No. The reference works tell you that the Ten Commandments were tiny round stones that Moses could carry both stones in one hand. The two stones would fit in one person's hand. They were referred to not as the Ten Commandments, but in Hebrew, they were called the Stones of the Testimony. And this is why today when you go to court, you're going to testify.
Yes.
Why do you have a testify or testimonials or Stones of the Testimony? The very word Stones of the Testimony comes from the word testes. So in ancient Egyptian, when you went before the courts in ancient Egypt and in ancient Judaism, and you go before the court, where you go in the court today in Israel, you go as a man, you're going to testify about something, you must hold your testicles in your hand when you're testifying, because that's where the word testifying comes from.
testicles.
The idea being, if we catch you lying about your brother in this court, you're holding your testicles. You know why? Because you'll put your testicles on the line. You lie in this court, and you're never going to have a baby again.
Wow.
And so that's why you are testifying. And that's why when the man gets mad and angry and starts acting like you're mad, like he's bad and angry, women say you're getting testy, meaning you're feeling your testicles. You're feeling like a man. So now you're getting testy. Why? Because you're testifying. You're getting testy. Now, when he comes down from the mountain, he is bringing the Ten Commandments, which your reference works say were two round stones with the Ten Commandments written on both of them. One stone had Ten Commandments written all over it, the one round stone. The second stone had the same identical Ten Commandments written on it. So they were called the two stones of the testimony, which represented your testicle. That's why he could walk down with two round stones in his hand. It's his testicles. Mm. And they were the two stones of the testimony. Wow. Because that was the only way in Egypt they knew you're telling the truth. You better hold your testicles when you're testifying. Because if we find out you're lying, son, guess what? Mm. You're going to wish the hell you would never come in here holding your testicles because you're going to walk out here without them.
So maybe that was why it was shameful to be a eunuch.
That's exactly right. And so therefore, when Moses went up into the mountain, we will read in the Old Testament that Moses, who never lived, there was no man named Moses who ever lived. But the story is, when he went up into the mountain, he confronted God in a bush. It was called the burning bush. You ever hear about that?
Yep.
Okay. Moses, we are told, if you go and read the Bible, it said Moses went up into the mountain to talk to God. And when he got up there at the top of the mountain, there was a bush, a big bush, and it was burning. It was a burning bush. That's a very famous story in the Bible. Moses and the burning bush. Well, the burning bush was a female vagina, the burning bush. And that's where it comes from. Because the burning bush, the Bible says, when Moses went up there, he encountered God in the burning bush. That's the female sexual production part of our body. It's a burning bush. And therefore, she is on fire. That's why they have the song like, come on, baby, light my fire.
Yes.
It's called the burning bush. She's saying, come on, baby, light my fire. Because her burning bush is a vagina.
And then when you think about it, when he ejaculates, that's the water that cools the fire.
That's exactly right. And so therefore, she's saying, she was the burning bush. And Moses confronted God in the burning bush. Well, that's exactly what happens. Man, for the first time, actually connects himself to Almighty God in sex. Because if man don't get any closer to God than he is, making love to a woman.
Wow. And that brings forth
any closer to God than that. You know what? I could sit here for the next 10 hours and tell you all about the Old Testament stories in the Bible and how they all go back to sex and drugs and rock and roll. It's all just a story. The whole thing is a story so that one group of people can hold themselves out as holy and everybody else can go to hell. This is why the Jews will tell you they are God's chosen people. If I were a Jew, I would not have the balls to be able to go out in public and say, I am one of God's chosen people. God chose me. Who in the world would have the courage to go out with other people and say, I am one of God's chosen people?
Isn't that the true start of this racist concept? I am. You know, think about it. If I'm God's son, then I can't abuse you, Jordan. I can't mistreat you. I can't take your land, put your ass in slavery. Because you're nothing psychologically at that point, even though you truly are. You're a human being, deserving of respect and dignity. But all that goes out the way.
Yeah. Well, just think about this. All three major religions claim Abraham as their father. The Jews will tell you they have come from Abraham, their father. And the Christians will tell you that Christianity came directly from Abraham. And the Islamic people who do not know what is going on the earth, they have no idea in the world because Islamic leaders are not telling the people of Islam nothing. They're not telling them nothing. Keep them ignorant, ill-informed, and rant and raving, and keep them stupid and ignorant. And don't let them know what's going on. This way we can marry their little 7-year-old daughters and 5-year-old daughters and marry them and keep them for the night and bring them back to the parents the next day. In Islam, that is perfectly legal. If you pay the father to rent his daughter for the night, you can use her as your wife. Even if she's 5 years old, 6 years old, you can rent her. You pay the father. You pay the family. It's called an overnight marriage. So you pay the father, and he gives you his daughter, and you take her home, and she is now your wife. You have privileges with your wife.
Yes.
And so you can enjoy her in bed. She's only 7 years old or 5 years old.
Mm.
You can enjoy her in bed because that's the way Islam thinks. And so the man is the absolute father. He's the father of God. He's the whole father of all living things. He's the male. That means he can rape anything he wants any damn time he wants. And if you don't like it, he'll knock your teeth out, slap you around, and teach you a lesson. You don't tell the male in Islam anything. Period. He tells you. Where do you get the authority? He got the authority because he's got a heavy fist to beat your face in. That's what his authority. And so once you understand the way religions have developed, the use of sex and the domination of innocent children and innocent people, you know, we see all the stuff going on in Islam, of the marrying little 5-year-olds. Well, what about the priests? They're raping the 6-year-old boys. And we know it's pedophilia everywhere.
Yes.
Males and adults are raping young girls, young boys. They're there for the raping. That's why you have altar boys. In the Catholic Church, because you are putting them on the altar to be sacrificed.
Wow. Now, Jordan, Jordan, do we find the same system in Hindu or other religions? Like the same basically premise, we're going to dominate your body?
That's basically what it is. It is basically the domination of the human family. All humans, even the men, are being dominated by extraterrestrials. So the men are dominating the women and children and raping them. But somebody's raping the human family, period.